So, to this morning's lecture, Paula's lecture, we'll take us one step forward, which is what happened, how did it work when the Jews from Arab and Islamic lands came to Israel? And in particular, how did it work? How were they absorbed? Remember, we're dealing with a poor country at the time, right? The country absorbed as many people into the country, as many people were absorbed into the country as were already here in a year or two, or three. No, 3 years, right? So you can imagine today, let's say China had to absorb in the next 3 years 1.4 billion people, right? The state of Israel had to absorb the size of its population in 3 years. It was no small task. And so how it worked, we're going to hear from Paula, and that's what we're going to see for ourselves today.
Thanks, Arya. And I think it also fits very well into, the idea is to give you an introduction, the solid ground that you need in order to, when you go out there to the tour today, in a way, we're giving you a better equipment for that tour. What?
For tour, yeah.
Exactly. I mean, what you'll have is better glasses to see what you see around you. Because other than just meeting with communities and people who are doing interesting things, the idea of this lecture is to be able to give you the ability to reflect, relate what you see in the tour to where this all started, to the context. And I think you will be more sensitive. Your ears will hear more and your eyes will see more. If you have a background for how these towns and these communities were shaped. So that's the idea. So the title of this big project, I think, if we look at it from the policy aspect, is population dispersal. So the challenge of immigration and the policy that was developed following the idea of the challenge of immigration was a policy developed that was called the policy of population dispersal. This did not happen by itself. And what we're gonna, I invite you to join me in this journey to look at how this policy was implemented and also to try and understand it, the rationale, the raison d'être of this policy, and also to look at the results and the consequences. Some of them were some of them are consequences that Israel is still dealing with in these very days of that policy. I'm beginning with a quote from the first government plan because it all has to do with the radical change, the dramatic change that occurred after there is a state. If yesterday you all talked about Zionism and the triggers and the engines that led to the establishment of a Jewish state. So, Mazel Tov, we have a state now, and I'll read a paragraph from the government plan, the paragraph that refers to the policy making of population dispersal and integration of newcomers. We might be moving from a great era, an era of heroism and victories. By the way, it's Ben-Gurion. Ben-Gurion himself has written that within the speech that presents the government plan, the first government plan in 1949. So we might be moving from a great era, an era of heroism and victories, the era of the day after, days of routine, effort of state organizing, lacking glamour of demanding and exhausting labor. Why does he refer to we might be moving from, okay, or the day after? The sense that people had in Israel when it was just established was the sense, imagine yourself working really, really hard for the exams, and then you finish the exams, and what do you want to do, right? Okay, I'm done, right? I mean, you don't need to do anything else. Now let's just lean back and rest. Well, that was not an option. The fact that there was a 1.5 years war, a bloody war, the fact that there was there were 50 years of strong effort to reach that point of the establishment of the state by far did not mean that now the job is over. That in fact, it was the opposite. Now it was only starting. When you declare, when you gain sovereignty, when you gain the recognition of the international community that now you are a political recognized entity, now you have to start working. But in the case of Israel, start working was not a gradual, long-term process. There were some burning issues that have to be taken care of on the spot. So, but in fact, says Ben-Gurion, okay, to, that we might be moving, okay, from the great area to the day after. However, we still have demanding and exhausting labor. We have to house the newcomers and absorb them. We have to make the desolated land lands fertile. We have to build factories to organize transportation on land, sea, and air. Things basic, you know, roads, jobs, housing. We have to provide education services, healthcare, national and social security to raise the necessary means more than ever before for security, for immigrant absorption, and for the service of a state and a nation. And the two terms that I chose to highlight here, or three terms, but the two terms that you will see are somehow intertwined with each other, are security and immigrant absorption. And although one might think that security has to do with international relations and security issues, that it has to do with army issues, you will see that there was a strong connection between the concept and the policy that that was focused on immigrant absorption and issues of security. So let's take a look at that. What is the connection between massive wave of immigration and population dispersal? Okay, we all understood, I guess, I assume that you all understood, that you all understand now, based on the various lectures that you had yesterday, I assume that you all understand by now why there was this urge to open the gates of the country and allow every Jew to come in, to send this message that there is one place on earth where every Jewish person can join, unconditional, and become part of a majority. So I think by now I don't have to explain why that was like a given. When I teach my semester class, I always use the key. I have my keys. I don't have them here, but I have lots of keys because, you know, I'm the director here, so I have all the keys of the institute. So I have all these keys, like, you know, like in the jail where you have all these keys that make all these noises. And I always give the example to my students that a major task of the Zionist enterprise was who owns the keys, right? I mean, who has the keys to the doors? It was a major task, and for years and years, others owned the keys. So, and even when the Zionist movement was already implementing its plans for statehood and sovereignty, still the British had the keys. So it was when finally there is a state, there is sovereignty, there is a government, a sovereign government, they have the keys. So they are the ones who decide whether the doors of the country will be open and who is entitled to come in. And one decision that they took that is still intact in Israel is that this is going to be the one place on earth where Jews will be able to come unconditionally. That's one aspect of it. But the other aspect of it, when they come, why do you decide, why does the government decide that they have to, why is so much given on their shoulders? What is the connection between that massive entrance of people and the idea of population dispersal? And another question that the government and the policymakers have to deal with all the time is, are these two tasks, massive immigration, okay, and population dispersal, are these two tasks complementary or contradictory? okay? It, do they go hand by hand, or do they? Is it a problem that a country wants to do both at the same time? Okay, so let's take a look a bit at the rationale behind it. I'll go through it really quick. I just want to give you, because I want to move on to how it actually functions. But if we look at the idea of population dispersal, especially when we look at the Negev region, which we are now placed in, is 60% of the 60% of the state of Israel, and it was unpopulated. There were Bedouin tribes that were settling here and there, but by and large, definitely after the war, when many of the Bedouin tribes fled away, the Negev was unpopulated. And the question was, okay, what was so urgent for the government to fast populate the Negev in a way that will actually, in an artificial way, will bring the people and settle them in newly established towns, those towns that you will have a chance to see today as you go to your tour. So there are different explanations to that. I'll go through them really fast. I will say that we're talking about there was a constant challenge on those lands. Israel's borderlines were always challenged. They were challenged from day one. There were different pressures from outside questioning, okay, which territories will remain and which will not. So the assumption was that if you want to gain your right to get that those territories will eventually will become and remain part of your state, you have to demonstrate that you really need them, that you're using them, that you're living on them, that you're populating them. Oh, sorry. Oops. Okay, so that's one thing. Another thing has to do with the whole way of thinking of the Zionist enterprise. Yesterday, when you read the texts in the workshop, I guess one of the groups had a text of Bill Katzenelson that talked about the connection between socialism and Zionism. The concept of the socialist movement in the Zionist enterprise was that the new Hebrew person should be developed. The idea was that you have to sit on your land and develop it. You have to create your own means of livelihood. It was about creating an independent, your own self-sufficient community. When you look at it and when you understand that idea, and you go into the minds of the shapers of Israel's policy in its first days, it was very important for them to demonstrate that the Jewish state is not only holding territories, but it's actually utilizing those territories. That it is capable, that the state is capable, that the territories are utilized for the purpose of livelihood, and that these territories are used for future development of agriculture, of means of livelihood. It was a fundamental concept in the labor movement, the Zionist labor movement, that it's not only about having a state, a political entity, it's also about creating a self-sufficient community that lives on that land and is capable of producing its own food from that land, even if it's arid. So that was, I call it the moral justification, okay? You will read, all these are quotes of David Ben-Gurion. Perhaps we can send you the PowerPoint or those texts later on, so you will be able to read them, but you'll see when he talks about the development of the Negev, he refers to those aspects as well. There's another aspect when we look at the population dispersal, and that is something that has to do directly with security, an idea that Ben-Gurion developed in 1949, and it took us until 2006 to realize how accurate his vision was, believe it or not. He talked about it in 1949, and it was only in 2006 that, as we say in Hebrew, ha-simon nafal. You remember there were pay phones when you would put a little dime inside and call before we had the smartphones? Okay, so there's a saying in Israel, when you put the coin into that pay phone, and you put it in, and when someone answers, it falls down, okay? So it took us more than 50 years to realize that this, when that dime fell, and we, well, he did have a point, Ben-Gurion, okay? And this is what I'm referring to. I'm referring to the existential aspects of the development of the Negev and of other, let's say, other unpopulated areas of the country. I want to read it. A million and a half, it's a quote, yes? 1.5 million Jews are concentrated in few urban clusters. This causes danger for both the people and the land. The concentration of this majority is just a small area. Threatens the whole state. It is very easy to wipe away Tel Aviv and its surroundings at once. And if that happens, the state is lost. The only shield protecting us from this danger is the spreading of our population, the dispersing of our population. Now, why am I reading this out loud? Because Ben-Gurion, this is something, it was like a mantra, okay? If you can say David Ben-Gurion is kind of obsessed about it. We cannot allow everyone, a state cannot survive if 90% of the population lives between what we call Gedera and Chedera, okay? Between a little south of Tel Aviv to a little north of Tel Aviv on that very narrow stripe of the coastal plain. Because one bomb that falls there, if it's big enough, end of story, okay? Then we have to restart the whole system and then, okay, end of story. Now, when Ben-Gurion talked about that concrete threat, yes, it's 49. So the atomic bomb, the nuclear bomb is already a given fact, and people already know what was the result. At least they think they know what was the result of that. But most of the people thought that the bombing of Tel Aviv, which did occur in 1948, will not occur again. It will not happen again. It happened once, end of story. And then came 2006, and we all woke up into a new reality where actually bombing of urban centers is a given in Israel. I don't know how many of you have been here last summer. Those who come from Rehovot, I can tell you, my mother lives in Rehovot. I know how tough it is. How tough it was, but clearly people who live in Tel Aviv, in Rishon LeZion, in Haifa. So this is one more. This was a challenge that Ben-Gurion and his government thought that the state had to deal with, and the only way to deal with it is to make sure you have enough population dispersal. You need to have additional urban centers, additional big centers of population, so then when there's one place threatened, the other place is protected. Okay, then you can balance between places and provide a shelter to various. Okay, so that's one aspect. The aspect, one challenge. The challenge is that there are arid lands. There are unpopulated areas. The state of Israel has gained recognition. It has gained victory in a long war, and now it was under its sovereignty, under its responsibility, were these lands that were unpopulated, and it was considered moral, existential, and also an international diplomatic commitment to the expectations of the international community. So all these three factors were very crucial to define a policy, and they led to the definition of a policy that population dispersal was an official policy of the first government of Israel. Let's put that aside. Now let's look at the immigrants for a minute. Here are the people that Esther talked about last night and also that were portrayed in a humoristic way by Sarah Shabati, okay? So the people arrived from various places. This little chart gives you a sense, okay? Just a little sense of the challenges in terms of the unpopulation of areas, okay? So the land of Israel in 1948 is, let's say, 14 to 16 million dunams. The land in the Negev is 6 million dunams, okay? I would say it's not an accurate data because it doesn't, let's say it's actually more than that because there was always a question whether the area south of Rehovot should be considered Negev or not, but that's the minimum, okay? And then you have places that are populated by Jewish communities were 1 million dunams, okay? So clearly that's only to give you the sense of the need to populate areas, the need of dispersal of population. I'm going back to the immigrants. So you have an idea of you already understand what I mean when I talk about dispersal, the policy of dispersal of population, right? Why dispersal of population was considered to be a major task in Israel's first government agenda. Okay, I think that's now clear. Now let's take a look at the immigrants, at the other dimension of challenges. Okay, you will think for the first glance that I'm talking about something completely different, but then you'll see that both of them come together and they result in what you're going to see in your tours today. So, yes, as Ari said correctly, the population of the state doubled itself in 3.5 years. Okay, now this means, just to give you the let's say the just to illustrate it for you, okay? This means that every second person sitting around this table is a newcomer. Every person, second person, okay? So you're a newcomer, you're an old timer, you're a newcomer, you're an old timer, you're a newcomer, you're an old timer, okay? Now you say, okay, two groups. So let's say you want to know how to get to Rehov Herzl in Rehovot. Rehovot is my hometown, so I think that's my association. So Ari wants to know how to get to Rehov Herzl. So he comes to Luja and he says how to get to Rehov Herzl, but they do not speak the same language. So, you know, no big deal. I mean, she doesn't understand him, he doesn't understand her. No, what can we do? Then you would say, no problem, but what's your name?
Winky.
Winky. But Winky is also a newcomer. So what's the problem? Aya can ask Winky how to get to the Herzl Street, right? Here's the problem. Aya, he comes, let's say, from Yemen. Winky, she comes from Morocco. Not you, you're an old-timer. But what about you? What? Chi?
Yeah.
Okay, Chi, he comes from Hungary. Okay? What about you? Will? Okay. You come from Romania. Okay? So the fact that every second person comes from another place does not mean that every second person understands the language of the other newcomer. In fact, the newcomers came from tens of countries and tens of languages. So yes, the men amongst them knew Hebrew for prayers. They knew Arabic for prayers. But they didn't always even know how to use it for daily basis. So maybe they could communicate with each other for the case of having a common
gathering for prayer. But when they needed to ask how to get to Herzl Street, that's not in the prayers, you know what I mean? So yes, that was a huge challenge, a huge challenge.
In that time, English is quite popular.
Well, that was a great question. Listen, one of the things that we Israelis envy the Indians, the people from India, is that they decided not to mess with all the languages and to keep English as a major language. In fact, the Zionist enterprise was about returning to Hebrew. So in a way, English was not considered by far, there was no effort done to preserve English. In a way, I would say the opposite of that. English was the language of the foreign rulers. So yes, the old timers, the ones who lived here under British mandate, they knew English. They didn't use it. Well, not all of them. Some of them had to use it. I'll illustrate it with a small story. Years ago, I was teaching a course on the 1948 generation. The 1948 generation is a title that we give for the young Israelis who fought the War of Independence. What is typical of that generation is that we're talking about many of them were second generation of indigenous Israelis. Okay? They were the representatives of the Hebrew person. They grew up in the country. They were raised here. They spoke Hebrew. I was teaching at Boston University at the time, and the language of teaching was English, and I really wanted the students to get a chance to hear the voice of someone of that generation, so I got in touch in the phone with a famous person. She passed away in time. Her name is Nativa Ben-Yehuda, which was an icon of that generation. And I said, hello, my name is Paula Kabalo, I teach at Boston University, and in Israeli, I would really appreciate if you would be willing to be interviewed for this class. She says, what language? I said, unfortunately, English. Silence. Then she says, well, Paula, you know, we don't know English. Okay? That was her answer. She grew up under the British mandate, but there was something there that didn't. English was considered to be the language of the foreign rulers, so I'm not saying they didn't know, those who grew up here. But what about those who came from Yemen? What about those who came from Morocco? What about those who came from Hungary? What about those who came from Romania? Did they know English? No. Unless they received a certain education, unless, in fact, the education of academia was German. So those who came from Europe, there was a big chance that they would know German. Those who came from North Africa, they would know French. Well, so yes, they tried to speak in French with whom? With people who knew Russian. Okay? I can tell you that the mixture, it was a Babylonian tower. Okay?
Tower.
Now, okay, we won't go there. I will just say it was a mess. Okay? It was a potential. Okay, it was definitely a mess, but it was a potential of a cultural chaos, in a way. In many ways, it was a potential of a cultural chaos. So, that's the situation. Here are these people, here they are. In addition to that, if you want to make things even more complicated, we're talking about a country that is now recovering from a war. It's 1.5 years of war. So all the resources, went for the purpose of the war for 1.5 years. That means that you can imagine, okay? I think any nation, including the Chinese nation, understands what it is to recover from a war and how much time it takes to get the economy functioning again on a routine level and to reconstruct areas that were ruined, okay? So, in order to deal with that, the state declared an emergency economy. The emergency economy, just to keep it simple, the idea was that everything was centralized. There was provision of food, there was allocation of goods based on I would say, egalitarian criteria that took into consideration the purpose to distribute as equal as possible the limited goods in order to be able, A, to overcome the crisis after the war, and the fact that in the midst of this crisis, the population has been doubled. Another thing that came out of this, another challenge that was the result of that, was of course the basic. Because yes, we all need food, and then we all need roof, right? These are two basics. Food and roof are basics, and there was a lot of effort was invested in trying to find fast, rapid solutions for these people that were flowing in. So any available, okay, any deserted town, during the war, there were areas that were deserted by the Arab population of the country. There were other places that were deserted by the British army. So any available infrastructure was used, but very soon that was not enough. So the government had to find out all kinds of other solutions. The idea was to provide as soon as possible housing solutions, and the first step was to create camps. As simple as that, to create camps, and that's why the other photo you probably saw, there were tents. Okay, so some of the newcomers came in and were put in tents, and then the idea was to create transitional neighborhoods, meaning to bring industrial mobile houses, you know, wood cabins, and to put them, okay, to bring them with big trucks, to put them someplace near, mostly near the big cities, so they could use the infrastructure that existed there. So this is how many of the poor marginal neighborhoods of Israel have started. They started as a transitional camp, to find fast solutions to give roof for newcomers. And then the next step was, but clearly that was a compromise, that was not a good solution. And then gradually, side by side with understanding the needs of the dispersal population came they. So the combination of people who need roof and a nation that needs people, so the combination of these two led to the developing of the two major means of livelihood for immigrants. One of them, we'll get in a minute, is the immigrant villages. Many of them were settled here in the western part of the Negev. If you, all of you know where the Mediterranean is, I think you probably had a chance to either see it or visit it, right? Those of you in Haifa have it there. You have your own seashore there all the time. Those who live in Jerusalem and in the Negev know we don't have it there. So we have to go especially. But if you take the Mediterranean and you go from north to south, you can see that the southern part of the Mediterranean, let's say if you take the Mediterranean and go towards east, the stripe there is full of immigrant villages that were government policy to find housing solution for immigrants who just came in. Another famous place that was allocated for immigrant villages is the road to Jerusalem via Beit Shemesh. Okay, via Beit Shemesh. Those of you who live in Jerusalem, I don't know if you had a chance to go to Jerusalem, not through route number one, but when you take a detour. So areas, the idea was to take territorial stripes and to put immigrant villages there. And another means concept of creating centers of population and providing roof, meaning populating desolated areas and at the same time providing roof for immigrants, was the famous development towns of Israel. And we'll look at them in depth in a minute, but I want to say a word about them. The term development town was supposed to refer to the creation of medium-sized urban centers in unpopulated areas. That was the idea. The idea was that, why was it called development towns? Because the idea was that these towns, the purpose of the towns was to develop it, to develop undeveloped areas. That was the whole thing. It became throughout the years, because of the fact that mainly, first and foremost, immigrants populated those towns. Many of them did not choose to go there. They were given roofs, so that's how they ended up there. So it ended up as a, I would say, as a word that has a negative connotation. Nowadays, people that live in development towns do not like those towns to be called development towns, okay? And actually, we try to avoid that term nowadays. If you, we will take a look at them in a minute. I will just say that we're talking about medium-sized towns. That was the idea, to create urban centers so that, naturally, not all those people that were relocated, that were taken there to live there, could live from agriculture. So the idea was to create, through those urban centers, centers that would provide services, and also centers where people could find more diverse types of employment. And we'll talk about that as well. Because, as I said, the two basics were food and roof. But there's also a third basic, and that's jobs, and that's livelihood. You do not want to bring people, give them roof and food, and then make them dependent on others for the rest of their lives. So these were three major challenges the state was dealing with from day one. Okay, from day one. So just to give you a sense, okay, I already mentioned that, but just to give you a sense of it. In November 1948, almost 80% of the Jewish population resided in 10% of the land, okay? Now, they might have been spread, but what I'm saying is that, okay, they were here and there, they were sparse. In the coastal plain, okay? And then you had, what I want to illustrate here is that 80% were, when I say 80% were in the coastal plain, I mean 80% were in the cities. Tel Aviv, the towns around Tel Aviv, Petah Tikva, Rehovot, okay, including Haifa, okay, 80%. And only a little, okay, only around 20% were in other areas, the Galilee, the Negev, okay, and the Western Galilee, the Eastern Galilee, and the Negev. Okay, that's the general challenge. Okay, I want to move on and look at the two types that I just mentioned. So here are the challenges. These challenges lead to this policy making of the first government of dispersal of population. This policy is taken side by side with the other policy component, which is, remember, the keys, okay? Opening the doors and letting all Jews come in, okay? So the idea of massive way, two policies somehow come together. One, the massive wave of immigration, or I would say biblical term, the term that Ben-Gurion used a lot, the ingathering of exiles, that was the term, and the term was used, you have to understand when you look at Ben-Gurion's speeches, and not only his, when you look at the speeches of policymakers, the leadership of the State of Israel, they used the term kibbutz galuyot in a very serious way, okay? Kibbutz galuyot is a biblical, it's a nice term to talk about, okay, the gathering of exiles. It's not just a slogan, it's a policy. The idea is the State of Israel has a goal to bring, to open its doors for as many Jews as want to come in. Okay, that was one aspect of, so that's one component, one clause in the new government's policy. Another clause in the new government's policy is the clause of population dispersal. I think that by now we all understand why that was important. Now, when you put those together, you have unpopulated areas that have to be populated, and you have immigrants that already came in, and now they need food, roof, and jobs. So when you put these things together, it only makes sense that the immigrants who come in will be sent to populate those areas. Now, of course, that was a policy from above. So it's not that every single person who said, will you be so kind to come and live in that unpopulated area? We're talking about massive challenges. We're talking about masses that come in completely without any resources of their own. So clearly it was a decision making done, taken by the government. For the individual, it meant that he will be provided food, roof, and eventually jobs by the government. But it also meant that no one really asked him, where would you like to live? Where would you like to live? Where would you like to live? If you had your own resources, you would go and choose where you would like to live. But if you didn't have your own resources, which was the case in most of the immigrants, then someone else decided for you where will you live and what will be given to you, what will be the package. And the package, as I said, included these basic components. I want to talk about the immigrant villages and why immigrant villages were chosen as the first solution for housing when it was clear that people have to be taken from those camps, from those desolated villages, when the new format of housing of communities was developed, why was it rural villages that came first? Even before the development house. So a major issue was food. There was a need to provide, it's one thing that you bring people in and you know that you have to give them food, but you need to have food, means of production of food. That's not enough to say, yes, we will give, okay, so we'll find the funds and move to the people. You need the food to be, well, you need the food to be produced. And so the idea was to increase the food production and to decrease dependency on imports, okay, which means dependency on foreign currency. And the idea was that if they go and live in those immigrant villages, then they provide their own food for themselves. That was the hope. It also meant that people who go and live in those places and start to grow their own food, they are employed. They have a job. Then they don't feel humiliated. They don't feel worthless. It was a huge tension or threat, even I would say. The immigrant camps were referred to by policymakers as a ticking bomb. Why did they call it a ticking bomb? Because when you bring people that had dignity in their, wherever they live, it doesn't matter, even life was hard. They have to struggle for livelihood. First of all, some of them came from very good, from middle and upper classes. Those who came from the lower classes, nevertheless, they had their communities, they had their livelihood, they had their dignity. You uproot people from one place to the other, and now they have to start all over again. And the longer they stay dependent on others to provide them, they might be grateful that people are providing them with food and roof, but the sense of dignity is lost there if you do not wake up in the morning and go out there and gain your own bread. So the idea of the villages was that here we can provide immediately a means of livelihood, because each of these family households receives a little plot of land, and they receive basic seeds and they start to do their agriculture. Or they receive two cows and they start to do a little bit of milk production. So the idea was food, but not less important, the idea was also the employment of immigration. But of course, as I said, the major issue was the housing, the roof. And the idea was that
you have to, the idea was that the, as far as possible, people have to have their own place, to have their own homes, and therefore it is, the idea was to, when, and to create a village is easier than creating a city. You need less infrastructure. You need a couple of houses, some roads, and that's it. And perhaps some connection to the electricity. To create a village was a fast solution. So because of all these three things, the immigrant villages were chosen and were considered at the beginning as having the advantage over creating medium-sized cities. Because as we said, people are flowing in. You have to, as fast as possible, direct them to their permanent communities. What were the problems with it? Well, the problems were that many, many of these people never dealt with agriculture in their lives beforehand. Actually, most of them lived in urban centers, and they were merchants, or they had free all kinds of liberal arts professions, or mostly dealt with businesses of many sizes or crafts. So, in distinction from the kibbutz movement, I don't know if you had a chance to hear about the Zionist enterprise and the ideal of the living in rural areas and creating this self-sufficient community. It was a big ideal, but these people didn't hear about those ideals. Many of them were not exposed to those ideals of, yes, let's dirty our hands with the mud and feel that we're growing our own trees, because this means that we're becoming normal, like all other people in the world. Well, the people who came from Yemen and worked in crafts there, or the people who came from Morocco and had their businesses there, for them it was not such a nice thing suddenly to be sent and put their hands in the mud. Okay? They lacked the idealism that came alongside with it and gave it such a glamour when for the kibbutz movement, elite group in Israel. Another thing that was very problematic was the family structure. While the founders of the kibbutz movement were young and beautiful, okay, let's say, they were on their own. Usually they were young when they started the kibbutzim, they did not have families, they were just like in the posters, they were tanned, okay? They had this hair, okay? The wind, you know, it was this sense of freedom and connectedness to nature. Fine, okay? I was in a kibbutz myself when I was very young. I went as part of my youth movement group, went to a kibbutz, and I remember myself when we just arrived. It was a kibbutz in the near Afula, near the Beit She'an Valley, okay? And I remember myself, somewhere in the north, okay? Because you realize you probably don't know, somewhere in the northeast side of the country. Anyhow, I remember myself arriving in the kibbutz with my friends. We were all 18 years old, and it was a sense that we were now going to be like the pioneers. And I remember myself coming back from work. We worked with the onyx, and it was like hard work with the trees and agriculture. You get, you're all full of scratches. And then you take a good rest and a nice shower, and you dress with a dress, and you walk in the fields of the kibbutz, and your hair goes, the wind blows your hair and your dress. You feel so free. It feels so significant. It gives you a sense, I will never forget, the sense of worth that it gave me just to walk barefoot, okay, in that field, feeling the... But I was trained to understand the significance of that. I was trained to love it. I was trained to feel that I'm part of a bigger thing. What about my father-in-law, who came from Morocco, who lived in Casablanca? He comes from a family of merchants. What about his sisters who came, he got married here, but what about his sisters who came when they already had three children, four children, and then they brought with them the grandfather and the grandmother, so we're talking about three generations.
some elderly. You can imagine them being sent to this place to start from scratch. You look around, you see the mountains, you see the sea. Who could see the beauty? The only thing that you feel is how itchy are the mosquitoes, you know? It's really, there's nothing romantic about it when your child is crying because he's hot, when you don't have enough milk to give him, when you need to give him, you need to give him a special, the special baby food, and then the truck will come only in 2 days and give the supply. No romanticism whatsoever. It's just a pain in the neck. So the family structure was definitely not suitable to the idea of creating new communities in distant locations that would be based on a whole change of lifestyle. Another problem that occurred as a result of these villages was that simply they did not know how to do it. They were not trained to do agriculture. They were not trained to have animals. Most of them, when I say most of them, I mean the vast majority of them, okay, probably be above 95%, okay, did not have any background in agriculture. They were city dwellers, were small cities, big cities. Perhaps some Jews who came from the villages in North Africa, from the Atlas Mountains, perhaps they did have some, but we're not, that they came later, but in any case, even they didn't necessarily know agriculture is a serious thing. You may be an expert in growing wheat, but that does not mean you know how to grow apples, right? And you can be an expert in growing apples, but that doesn't mean you have any clue about cows, right? So no one asked them, you're an expert in dairy production, so we'll set up a dairy, how do you call it?
A refit.
Cow. I forgot the word. Okay, I'm glad. Because no, I'm so good, I'm not the only one.
Place where you milk cows.
A what?
The place where you milk cows.
Okay, yeah, that place where you milk cows, we call it refit. Anyhow, so yeah, no one asked those people, so they end up arriving in those places and they lack the previous knowledge in agriculture. And the people from the organizations who bring them there and provide them with the means and invest money, it's not that they are not aware. One of them is quoted saying, "We will bring them," meaning the immigrants, "we will bring them to agriculture whether they want it or not, whether they are trained or not." Listen to this. "We will bring them to the agriculture whether they want it or not, whether they are trained or not." Why is he saying that? Is he saying that because he's looking down at them, because he wants them to suffer, because he doesn't want them to succeed? He is saying that because he thinks agriculture is the fundamental source of livelihood. He thinks that Israel needs to have enough people in agriculture in order to increase the food production. You need to have it. And if you do not, so he says, okay, what can we do? That's what we need. So then whether they want it or not, we need it. Whether they are trained or not, we still need it. Okay? Actually, in the Hebrew phrase that he says, that he uses afterwards, remind me, I will explain it to you, but I need to say it for Ari because he knows Hebrew. Umishelo leshama yevo leshama. Which is great, okay? It's like he plays with the Bible, like the Jewish resources and diverts it to whether they like it or not, they'll have to do it and it will be fine, okay?
We started late.
Ah, so are the Matanishi?
I think it was supposed to be from 10:30, but we're supposed to leave the 11:00.
Ah, okay. Okay, as Adesavachitzi, okay. So, I'll talk about the development times, and then we'll open it for questions. So, okay, pros and cons. The idea of the villages was maybe important, was necessary. It definitely did not provide solution for all of the masses of immigration. very clear that you need to have also urban centers, because at the end of the day, you can pile, you can concentrate bigger chunks of population. You can create bigger communities in cities and not in small villages that work. Just to give you a sense, I just came back from Argentina visiting my brother, and he lives in a village, a real village. I mean, some of the roads are not even paved. People have chickens in their backyard. And I know the village. I visited many times, and I asked him, how many people live in your village? And he said, 100,000. Just to give you a sense, I fainted. I mean, that's like a big city in Israel. Okay, that's a big city. And they still have the nerves to call it a village. I mean, it's not a village. I don't know what the size of villages in China, but the size of villages that we're talking here, we're talking about 500 people were the bigger ones, including the kids. Okay, those are the numbers. Okay, so we're talking about 100 families, 80 families. That was the concept of villages, because that was the idea that you put up a couple of houses. Okay, so yeah. So how many villages can you have? You will have 100 villages, and you have a solution for 5,000 people. Nachon? Siti cheshbon nachon? No, 50,000. But still, that's nothing. But they didn't even have 100 villages. They had around 60 villages. So you can make the calculation. Those who learn mathematics will do the calculations, and those who learn history will receive the results of the calculation. Anyhow, the bottom line is that they needed a solution for 700,000 people, and the villages could not provide, in the most ideal utopian format, the villages would provide 50,000. Okay? So that's definitely not enough. Clearly, they had to turn their eyes and their efforts and their imagination to the idea of creating urban concentrations. And this is how the idea of the medium-sized towns, the development towns, came into being. Now, believe it or not, it's not an Israeli idea. Israelis are sure that we invented the development towns, and that actually it's one of those not so successful policies that were enacted. Some people say, well, there was no other choice because people had to be housed. And others some of the people who grew up there, not everybody, but some of the people who grew up there say, they actually criticize the government for taking that policy. So until this very day, when I meet with people who, I have a big family from one of those towns, actually, most of my family in Israel lives in Dimona, it's one of those towns that you will visit today. And I have many opportunities to speak with people who have spent three generations living in Dimona. And some are very happy and love it and think it was, eventually it was for good because they have their community, they have their place, they have their children there, they have their grandchildren there. Actually, in my family, it's only four generations, which is there. But some left the city and remained with Android. They left the city, they live in Tel Aviv, they live in the center of the country, and they feel that they got away from there. And they succeeded because they got away from there. And since I am considered to be the representative of David Ben-Gurion on earth, because as the director of the Ben-Gurion Research Institute, people think that I have to I have to speak on his behalf all day long. So people actually come to me and complain, "You're Ben-Gurion! It's your Ben-Gurion! It's he, and it's only because of your Ben-Gurion! And your Ben-Gurion did this, and your Ben-Gurion did that, and he sent us to the development house. He threw us there in the middle of the desert." Do you think, like, just a year ago, I was sitting in a family event, a friend said, she said to me, "You think I forgot what he did to us?" I didn't. Okay, I said, "What?" So I said to her, "Look at you. Did you ever look at the mirror? You're a very successful woman. Okay? You have great kids. You have a great family. You did very well in your life. What did it do to you?" I said to her. She is still angry. I'm telling you this story because the development towns were considered for many, until this very day you can say, they are still an unfinished business in Israeli discourse, you can say. Nowadays it's changing. It has become the discourse between center and periphery, more than the discourse between old-timers and newcomers. Okay? But it all began, believe it or not, with a need to solve, okay, food, roof, and jobs, the need to solve the issue of unpopulated areas, the need to put these together in a way that will provide a solution of livelihood for many people, not only for 500 people in one village, okay? And the concept was adopted from Europe, the new town concept, the idea that was developed in Europe to create small and medium-sized towns, assuming that you cannot have, the big towns are becoming bigger and bigger and bigger, you cannot have all people living in those huge towns. You need to have like a moderation of different levels of lifestyle. So when the development towns were established, there were generally speaking two types of development towns. One of them were, I would say, towns were supposed to become centers for rural, okay, rural-urban combination. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the towns of the Western Negev, Ofakim, which is the Lot Netivot. You're not familiar, but after this, you know, after the seminar, you probably Google some stuff, you could see it's in the western part of the Negev. And the idea was that in the midst of those villages, a town was established. The idea was that there would be a small town. Small town, the idea was that eventually it would become maybe 10,000 people, but in fact these towns always remained around 5,000 people. And the idea was that they will provide mainly like a center for the agricultural industry. So people who live in the villages will have the bigger clinics, they will bring their production there. So it will be like the center, an urban center for a rural area. That was one style. Then you have the medium-sized towns that you would probably call them district towns, okay? They would include government branches, banks, hospitals, industry. I would say that medium-sized, the most typical perhaps example would be Kiryat Gat or Ashkelon. Kiryat Gat is where Rabbi Dr. Sharon Shalom lives in. So the idea was that Kiryat Gat is not too far, I would say it's between Tel Aviv and Be'er Sheva, you can say. Actually, to be more precise, it's between Be'er Sheva and Rehovot. Using again the Rehovot example, because you know, for us Rehovot, for the people from Rehovot, we have a reputation of being very self-centered. So, yeah, so Rehovot is the center of the world, in case you didn't realize, but in any case, so between Rehovot, Kiryat Gat is there. Actually, Kiryat Gat, Ashkelon is another, Ashdod, two more. Ashdod is a more famous one, I think. On the seashore, south of Tel Aviv, now it has become not a medium-sized city, now it's a big-sized city. It was supposed to be a medium-sized city, okay? And the idea was that in those places you would have hospitals and bigger industries. They didn't always end up having hospitals. In Ashkelon there is a hospital, which is part of that concept. Anyhow, I will not go through all the examples. I will only, this is just to give you a sense of the development towns that were set up only in the Negev. You also have development towns in the Galilee. I think that you have a map here. In a minute, we'll be able to see it. Today, we will visit Yerucham, okay, and Dimona, okay? Dimona was always defined a city in the middle of nowhere, okay? The idea was that it's a nowhere, it's in the middle of nowhere, but it's a place rich with minerals, so the assumption was that there is a good chance to provide livelihood using industries that will be based on the minerals that are in the area. Meets Yerucham that we will visit was supposed to be on the road. On the road to Eilat, eventually they changed the road to Eilat. Also, Mr. Ramon was supposed to be on another road to Eilat, they changed that road to Eilat as well. Yerucham actually at the beginning was even found in Morza as a village, and only later on it became a town. Mitzpe Ramon is a very interesting story. You will see Mitzpe Ramon on Wednesday. Mitzpe Ramon is an interesting story. Probably most of the people that live in Mitzpe Ramon today do not know this story. And the story goes that the ones who started Mitzpe Ramon were actually not newcomers. The pressure to create Mitzpe Ramon came from old-timers that wanted to see another urban center in the Negev, far more, even more distance from the center. And the idea that they had was to create an urban kibbutz, a collective city. So there was a lot of idealism around Mitzpe Ramon. I call Mitzpe Ramon an experimental community. Because until this very day, I think it has to do like when sometimes the founding fathers of a place, even if they fail, which was the case in Mitzpe Ramon, it never survived as a collective city, as a collective community. But until this very day, Mitzpe Ramon, though suffering from scarce population, and they always had chronic problems of employment, nowadays I think it's really in a road to prosperity. I think Mitzpe Ramon is in a very good place nowadays, but it was always special for its special experiments. So a group of artists come in then in the 70s, and we have dancers coming. You have all these artistic people coming and starting all these new enterprises. And now there's a new trend. Kids after the army go and spend their whole year. And now it's very cool. How do I know? My daughter tells me, my daughter who just finished the army came to us a couple of months ago. What are you going to do after the army? I think I'm going to go to Mitzpe Ramon. Now she grew up here all her life. He said, what? Why Mitzpe Ramon? Don't you want to go to the north to see green? I don't know, to change? Oh, it's so cool being in Mitzpe Ramon. Okay, so there's a new trend that I now know about. There's a jazz. Mitzpe Ramon, really? Is an example of a community that, although going through many hardships and many instabilities of people coming and staying and leaving and coming and going, it has preserved something in its experimental, the sense of, it always attracted experimental groups, I would say. And I think it has to do first with the first ones who created the city, and also with a view that I think is really not as nice as the Bokel, but almost as nice as the Bokel. I live here, so you're I can go on and on, but let me, Bersheva, okay? Bersheva was never supposed to be a development town, but because it was actually developed during the times that development towns were established, it was populated by immigrants, became characterized or affiliated with development towns in a negative way. When I say in a negative way, I don't say I share the negativeness. I just say that this is how the center of the country referred to it. It was considered a periphery, although Beersheba from day one was shaped to become the capital of the Negev. So Beersheba is one of the most interesting cases of a non-development town, that nowadays is, the fourth city or the fifth city. I think Rishon LeZion is winning in terms of numbers, but it's definitely one of the biggest cities in the country, and it has all the components of a capital. It does have a hospital, it has a university, it has colleges, it has government centers, okay, the court. So all the government centers are located in Beersheba. It's definitely a district capital in all the meanings of it. But in spite, and nowadays it also has huge commercial centers. There's a big boom going on around Beersheba in the last, I would say, 10 years. I've been living in the Negev for 20 years now. But I can tell you, since I studied in Beersheba in the 80s as well, I can tell you that for years Beersheba struggled with the image that was imposed upon it of an of a development town. This is just to give you a sense. So it's, you see the dots? These are the development towns that were established in those years. All the black dots you see from the high north to the south, and it was an enterprise. It was a declaration. It was a policy, and there were posters to acknowledge it while it was happening, but there were also posters to acknowledge it after the matter, okay? To give like a tribute to the development efforts. Here are some photos that give you the sense of how these places looked at the beginning, okay? So, Kiryat Malachi, again south of Rehovot, north of Kiryat Gat. Tzomet Kastina, Kastina Junction, for those of you who travel south, it's a very famous bus stop for those who travel by public transportation. Again, now it's a medium-sized city. Well, it's still struggling with images, but it doesn't have these tents anymore. The other one is Ofakim, one of those medium-sized, small-sized cities that were supposed to be centers for rural places. Here's the creation of the city of Arad. Again, you can see the trucks climbing up into the emptiness. And then eventually, Kiryat Gat, where Rabbi Sharon Shalom lives today. And I will show you at the end. You will see some photos of Kiryat Gat nowadays. Here's I think this is Mitzpeh Ramon, probably. I'll just wrap up. So just to give you a sense, okay? Here, this is where these people came to, okay? When they arrived in the country with very, very limited luggage. They would be accepted by the representative of the government. They would be taken on buses or trucks, depending when, and they would be brought to, if they were lucky, this is already in an advanced stage. So, but you can imagine the shock. So people came, they did not choose to go there. Eventually, some of them adapted themselves to the place and are grateful for having the chance to raise four generations of the same family in the same community. And others are still very critical about their parents being taken there. At the end of the day, what the individual could not understand, and perhaps does not have to understand, is the way the government looked at it. There's a difference between what the individual wants to have and what the government needs to provide. And the government, in order to provide food, roof, and jobs, and in order to make sure that the population, that the unpopulated areas are populated, these two things came together. And this is how the medium-sized towns of the country have been developed. And this is how the communities of immigrants, this is how the absorption of immigrants actually took place through these means. I'm jumping over. I could elaborate on how industries started there. I could elaborate more on the educational system. I will only say that clearly it came side by side with creating education, also not in one day, in a gradual process, and also industries, again, with a lot of trial and error. Industries that went well and industries that went bad. Industries that provided a dignified livelihood and industries that then went bad in the market and people became unemployed. So this has been a constant struggle of these places to find the right track, to find the right infrastructure that will allow them to prosper and to continue to develop. Now, believe it or not, these are the places today. this is a new neighborhood in Dimona. It's a new upper middle class neighborhood in Dimona. Really hard to find places here. nice houses, nice gardens. This is Kiryat Gat today. Okay? This is Kiryat Gat is going through a boom of construction. I would say it wasn't a completely gradual process. They built the projects, the place, not only Kiryat Gat. Many of these towns had housing projects, you know, grain houses, small flats, big families living in small flats, all the difficulties that came alongside with that. In the last 20 years or so, there's been a growing development of new neighborhoods, more attraction for younger couples, younger Israelis who say it's so expensive to live in the bigger cities. We need to find cheaper housing, and the so-called ex-development towns, or the medium-sized cities, or the urban centers of the Negev and the Galilee, actually nowadays have been attracting more and more younger couples in Israel that understand that at the end of the day, these places do provide everything that you need in order to have a good life. And in addition, you don't have to, you can afford, hopefully, buying a house, which is something that Israelis always wish to. It's a very important thing for the Israeli culture to have your own ownership on your own real estate. It could be a flat, okay, to have your own place. So, and this, believe it or not, is the most luxurious hotel in Israel, called Belchi. It's in the edge of the Machtesh. You will probably see it tomorrow. This is one more of the experiments of Mitzpe Ramon. Mitzpe Ramon finally realized a couple of years ago that it can offer this beauty. So yes, it's at the end of the, perhaps it's located at the end of the world, but it's a beautiful place. So now tourism has become a very big thing there. And this is just a sense of the uniqueness of the place and how it's used nowadays. So, to be continued in your tour, going to Yerucham and Dimona.